Are you ready for a great classic podcast?
JBTV, the respected name in music TV.
These are podcasts that no one has heard in many years. This is the JBTV podcast series, The Classics.
JBTV.
This is 1992, by the way. Hello, is this live? Hi, yeah, Jerry.
We're live, that's it.
Yeah, we just came into Chicago and I'm appearing on Jerry's show on JBTV. And, you know, I'm starting to feel old now. My body, you know, being so thin, at 24, my muscles were so toned, I'd look good. Now 34, you know, they're starting to flop. And, you know, I'm starting to look old. I was 32 waist for years and 9.5 stone. Now I'm 11 stone and 34 waist, which is like, what is going on?
So let's see your brand new music video right now.
Okay. That's called Drop the Sweetest Drop, or The Sweetest Drop. And it was filmed by Tim Pope in London last month. And it works out, it's about rapture. It's, you know, I tried to get, you know, the song's about rapture and about meeting and union of lovers, basically. Either, you know, male, female, whatever you want. In my case, it's male and female. In this case, it's male and female. And it's trying to convey that a perfect explosion when things meet. And albums are so fragile too. You know, vinyl is so fragile and scratchable, which kind of inspires a certain care, doesn't it? Yeah, I remember listening to, you know, albums through the scratches. When my sister first got her Dansette and she wanted to, you know, she'd been aching to play her Simon and Garfunkel graduate album for months. And we put it on finally. She said, "This is the most amazing music." She said, "You must listen to this." And I was six or something. I was like wide-eyed, wondering what the hell was going to come out of these speakers. And there it was, The Graduate, a classic of all time. And from there on, I proceeded to listen to things like Rolling Stones and sort of The Beatles and Bolan. And then that awful time when I was stained by the Velvet Underground and Bowie and stuff. And here I am, doing it. Cut you up, by the way, it's really easy. And go to E flat. No, E minor, sorry. D, C. And the chorus is G, F. Nothing to it. If I can do it, you can do it out there, guys. You know. But cheekbones help, by the way. Cheekbones and makeup and a bit of a front.
So anyhow, this is your first Freeform show you've been on?
Yes, it is. It's a real nice vibe, isn't it? You know, your toilet's very nice. I like your toilet. Yeah. Washroom, by the way, in American. And I just washed my hands and it was a wonderful feeling. There was this spotlight in this basically gold and brown interior. So what's going on? What can we talk about? We can talk about... what can we talk about? Peace, salam, shalom. That's a good one. Mm-hmm. Salam, shalom, and peace. Or even a peace, salam, shalom. Love, what's love? And happiness. Happiness is a guitar right around your neck for some people, isn't it? Happiness, I think, is... oh, God. It changes, you know, so much. You know, I go in and out of moods, or, you know, realities, all sort of, you know, throughout the day. I mean, you know, one minute I could be happy doing like a radio interview. You know, the next thought of doing the radio interview can be absolutely the opposite. So there's a hint there as to what happiness might be, and I think we can live our lives in such a subjective, illusory manner that we project all sorts of ideas of what's happy and unhappy, and actually, you know, forget to be there, you know. So maybe happiness is kind of, you know, letting go of fear and stuff, and just, you know, the fear to die, even, I think, so that you can, you know, you're not burdened with that fear all the time. Maybe that's happiness for you.
You believe in, like, life after death, or...
Oh, of course. I think you know that there's life after death. I don't think, you know, whether our individual minds actually believe it or not, I think we all know that it has to be the case in some form, some sort of, you know, transmutation of our being, of who we are. You know, we can't stop. But, you know, whatever form that, you know, whatever process takes place, that has to be a secret, I think, in that sense, that, you know, that's got to be kept from us, I suppose, in order to... If we knew the answers now, we'd cheat a bit, wouldn't we? Talking about life after death, you know, the hereafter, mine, the guitarist actually told me yesterday that, you know, he had this amazing dream. And I think, you know, some dreams are real and some are kind of illusory, you know, mind collages. And I think this one was real. It sounded real. He met his long deceased father, who died of cancer about 15 years ago, I think. And he was in quite a disheveled state. And he, you know, as if he'd been through a trial and a kind of a difficulty. And it was almost like, you know, this marked the end of it, this meeting. And he was basically saying, look, I'm here, I'm alive. And it was a very real experience, he said. And he basically warned him and said, what's it like over the other side? He said, what's it like there? And his father said to him, I'm not allowed to tell you. But basically, I've been paying for all the things, you know, the things I did wrong, basically. And he needed him to forgive him, I think, you know, to, you know, kind of allow him to move on. I thought that was quite a powerful image. And I totally believe that. I don't know why I'm telling you this, but I think, you know, since you raised the idea of life after death, I think that's one nice story that... graphically demonstrates it, I think.
You believe like a reincarnation, like you come back again? Or?
No, I don't actually. No, I think that's a confusion of images. I think there's a transmutation and a developmental process, either evolutionary or devolutionary. You know, you can devolve as much as you evolve, I think, in a way. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, the whole sort of myth of reincarnation into this form is a confusion of esoteric knowledge. But that's, you know, I don't know how to break that down and to explain that yet. It's kind of like that kind of knowledge is kept secret in the sense that it wouldn't be understood anyway, you know, even if it was expanded. I think now's the time when that kind of knowledge is being dispersed, expounded, and let out, you know. Mm-hmm. It's kind of something to do with the age. It's going to be a hard one. Your marriage, your lyrics, why don't we understand them? Can you explain your lyrics? To which I find an amazing opportunity for a 10-hour talk, you know. And then there's, what about the Gothic label? Mm-hmm. Why are you a legend? Yeah, the Gothic legend. And also, what was David Bowie like? Are you friends with David Bowie? Did you really worship David Bowie? Are you surprised that people compare you to him so much? And will Bauhaus reform? Number one. I'm just here doing a radio TV tour, and I played my first show last week in Germany, and I'm over here. Tomorrow we're doing the MTV thing, which is for 120 minutes. Haha.
With Dave Kendall.
Dave Kendall, who's an English person. Uh-huh. But it's basically just to get on TV. And what's new is that my drummer's leaving after the end of the American tour, which is a shame. I told Bryant, but, you know, there's absolutely no hard feelings at all. We love each other. We're mates still. But, you know, he just wants to move on and start a business, I think. I think, you know, the music business is a little insecure for him, which I can understand. So that's new. That's the latest. New is, what's new as well? Oh, yes, I'm going to be moving over to Turkey in 4 months,
wow.
4 months' time, which would be great. You know, I just want to go there and take myself out of water for a year or two, see what happens. You know, leaving attachments, getting to an area, where, you know, like a space and environment where you can't actually rely on old securities, you know. Mm-hmm. Being it, not necessarily dangerous, just a new place. A new feeling, you know. Maybe retire.
No, you're not going to retire, are you?
I don't know. maybe change into a, I don't know, maybe become a road digger.
Now, what would you want to do if you weren't doing music?
I think I'd like to either start a nursery, mm-hmm. or be a doctor of some kind. Not an actual doctor. I'd like to be a chiropractor or masseur. Actually,
why do I get these pains in my neck all the time?
maybe an artist or maybe a filmmaker. Yeah, I think that's a difficult area. I mean, you know, being in LA, it really puts you off the thing, you know, especially seeing The Player, which is something, you know about The Player, you know, the new film, The Player, which is like a satire on the Hollywood thing, which is like, you know, sums it up really. It's kind of
And we're proud to have you here as just before MTV, the first stop here is JBTV.
JBTV.
And here we go.
Come on, let's sign it. Yeah. Who's it to? To nobody in particular.
Nobody in particular.
So we'll do this.
I already see that artistic quality coming through here.
Yeah, look at this. He's an artist.
Yes.
I've hogged the space. You see.
That's okay.
Salam. Shalom. There you go.
Excellent. And there it is, right there. Peter Murphy signing the guitar along with Toad the Wet Sprocket live. Right. Did you ever hear of them, Toad the Wet Sprocket?
No, I didn't actually.
Yeah, they're a great new band.
Who's that? Danny Ash?
That's for Toad too.
Oh, man. Toad.
I don't know what that is. It's some kind of a little animal of some sort.
Yes. Yeah. Looks like one of Danny Ash's doodles. Uh-huh. So what else? Come on.
I don't know. What else do you want to talk about?
Well, you inspire me. What shall we talk about? Shall we talk about dreams? I don't remember every night that I dream. I remember some nights, and I remember, you know, just before tours, it's that old paranoia one where you go on stage and you're totally unrehearsed. You know, you don't know what songs you're going to be playing, but there's 10,000 people waiting out there, and it's a bit of a nightmare, really. Sometimes, I blank. Uh-huh. I mean, there's a couple of demos, not demos, a couple of live bootlegs I've heard of what I've done before, either in a Bauhaus, and there's one song, Dark Entries, that we decided to do as an encore for our last show. And I'm just like burbling nonsense. I forget the lyrics. But that nonsense can be quite good actually sometimes. Yeah, I don't love what I do.
No.
I think it's, you know, it's a trial. Uh-huh. It's, you know, I love it and I hate it. I think all of us love it and hate it. I think when you're, you know, put up in a spotlight on a pedestal, that can be quite a trial. I think that part I don't always like. I like the hour on stage. I don't like the 24 hours on the bus. I like the promise. I don't like the business. And I like doing this, and I might not like doing MTV. But overall, you know, the balance is that it's good, and I think there is a reason for doing it. And as long as that stays, you know, I'll carry on doing it. I think it's a strange existence, though, you know, relying on an audience, you know, relying on making records. Why are you making records? Why are you writing a lyric? Why are you doing this? You know, constantly, you know, asking why. When that why stops, you can just start doing it. That's why you're doing it, you know, because it's a creative process. Why ask why? Why not just act and do it? Are there responsibilities inherent in what we do? No, maybe that's over egotistical in a sense.
Is this your first alternative freeform show you've been on?
Yes, it is.
Really?
Yes, it certainly is the first one. This is good. This isn't so stiff. This isn't so set up. You know, the camera guy's laying down, having a good time, working quite hard. And we're just rapping, aren't we?
Yeah.
Talking, which is something that Peter Murphy hasn't ever done before, is he? On a TV show, he's usually asked very intense questions about Bauhaus and about the hunger and about Bela Lugosi's dead and what his lyrics mean. So you had John Lydon last week. Was he messed up? Was he criticizing everything? Or,
well, he came in. First, he had an interview with one of the radio stations here in town. So he came an hour or so early, because I guess that interview was cut off a little early. So the first thing he comes in, you know, like I showed you the studio and stuff, and he says, I don't fucking care. That was the first thing I thought, oh, this is going to be a sort of a, you know. So anyhow, no, he came in, and I told him, you know, that we're not going to ask any of the normal stuff, and it turned out real good.
People want to see them talking. I want to see them in their private moment that's exposed. I mean, this is exposed. I'm not in the studio. I'm not editing my voice. I'm not putting an effect on it. And, I don't have, like, a band around me ranting a song around me. So, you know, I can't hide in anything. So but that's always fascinating, that there's an onlooker in us all, a voyeur, isn't there, in us all. So, yeah, you know, that's fascinating. But, most people are kind of, most artists are kind of, you know, find it difficult. I think it's another job to, you know, to be a personality outside of what you do, i.e. acting, anything, out of, you know, the performing arts. You know, a dancer's not necessarily going to be a very articulate person, but, you know, you have to learn this erudite sort of a form of communication. It's kind of, you know, it's a university in itself. It's kind of, you know, you're my tutor asking me to, you know, to well, you're not particularly today, but most journalists are our tutors in the fine art course, asking us to justify our painting. So what is it, you know?
I don't know.
What do you say? I mean, you know, most of the time I'm listening to what I do myself. I'm listening to my lyrics. I'm just as much of a listener as you are, you know, and the songs too, you know. You hear stuff, you hear, you know, the album that... This latest album, Holy Smoke, this is a plug, isn't it? It's kind of, you know, I still don't hear it properly. You know, I'm not sure whether it's a good or bad album. Okay. We're starting in June in 1992. Mm-hmm. This is 1992, by the way. And we'll be starting to tour in June for 6 weeks. And we start on the East Coast and work west this time.
There you go, the JBTV podcast, where we bring you the best music, the best interviews, and it's all unscripted and totally unrehearsed. Follow us on all the social media and spread the word. This is JBTV Music Television, the JBTV podcast.
JBTV.